Our state has some incredible problems. My name is Lynn Hinderrocker. I'm here to talk about that with you and talk about the trends that have shaped this state and dragged us in one direction or another. We're not really realizing the dream we had way back in the early 2000s or even around 2008 or 9 or 10. My name is Lynn Hinderrocker. Welcome to Wild Biz Nebraska. We're going to get it on right now. Have you ever thought to yourself, how many customers do I have out there? I'm going to talk to you right now about a portion of our population that constitutes 50 million people. Actually, 38% of our entire population. So if you're interested in selling your product or service to 50 million people, who, by the way, are a little bit unique, they have a different value system, they have a different buying approach, a different decision process, listen carefully, and I'm going to talk to you about the urban naturals. I said that word smoothly. I'm going to say it slowly again. We're going to talk about the urban naturals. One word with an N combining two opposite words, urban and natural. It's a fantastic trend that you have to understand or it's going to drift away from you. Now here's the background on this, and this is a trend discussion, so there's no 13 tips to do right off the bat here in our little dialogue. Back in 2001, a gentleman named Richard Florida published a book that he called Cultural Creatives. And when I talk to people out there, they kind of know the word cultural creatives. Some do, some don't. It was a very hot book in certain circles, business circles mostly, with the Chamber of Commerce around the entire country. Every Chamber of Commerce executive was reading in 2002 and 3 Richard Florida's book about cultural creatives. And the point of the book was that you've got to have these people in your community if you want to have a lively, forward-thinking, progressive, money-flowing, resources, all right? And so everybody, of course, wants that, so everybody's studying this segment of our population. Now, what nobody knows, nobody knows this, these people had been studied by another demographer, another researcher, his name was Paul Ray. Brilliant man, who'd been studying these people, as well as the rest of the population, and comparing them to each other, of course, for over 10 years. And in fact, Paul Ray came up with the phrase cultural creatives, wrote his own book, very big, thick book, 2 years before Richard Florida wrote his book about cultural creatives. That's just a little sidebar, but a little interesting thing. These people have been watched carefully for over 25 years as they emerge and come up and really make a dent, reshape America. And by the way, reshape the Midwest where we happen to be taping this particular show. Now here's the thing. Cultural creatives were attractive to civic leaders and business people, of course, and community activists and so on because A, they were creative, right? They were tech savvy, very much so. So there's a lot of software development, software engineers coming out of that segment. And they had a strong interest in the environment. In fact, they were very committed. They looked at the whole thing with Earth in a different way. They didn't see the Earth as something to be used to serve their needs, but rather as something that they served the Earth. All right, it's a very different dynamic, a different paradigm. And by the way, it's probably much bigger than you realize right now. This particular sentiment that I'm trying to discuss has been discussed, of course, environmentalism for a long, long time. You wouldn't believe the number of people worldwide, from poverty-stricken people in third world countries all the way to the elite in Europe and Asia and so on, that have really bought in on the environmental thing. Not everybody is here, is that far along, but it's really cultivated out of respect for and sensitivity to the opinions of the cultural creatives, okay? So they're tech savvy, they're creative, they care about Mother Earth. And by the way, they also have a very strong opinion about, we'll call it religion or spirituality. Now let me back up and tell you this. There are two other segments besides the cultural creatives that exist on our planet today, all right? One is the traditionalists. That's not going to surprise you too much. The traditionalists wish the entire world was back, let's say America, okay, sorry, America, was back in the 50s. They really felt that that was the time when the country was healthiest and happiest and most secure, and everything was good back in those days, and there was conformity. Everybody was happy. They knew where they fit in, and there wasn't a lot of disruption. And so they wanted to go back there. Traditionalists just long for that nostalgic, calm, peacefulness. It's very attractive to them. Now, there's another group of people that we will call modernists. Okay, modernists are classic business people that get ahead, profits, efficiency, technology, go, 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 ambition, knock down barriers, and really try to get as much for yourself along the way as possible. So we have the traditionalists, we have the what I would call the moderns, and then we have the people in the middle. And Paul Ray originally labeled them transmoderns, okay? Because they blended and fused and mixed elements from both people, both parts of society, and came up with their own eclectic, I'm going to use that word a lot, eclectic combination of what they think life should be. So they had one foot in one side in the traditionalist world, one foot in the more business, modern, get ahead, go ahead kind of attitude. But they had their own unique approach. And by the way, this is not the political centrist group that you might be thinking of. They hate all that. They hate that whole idea about left, right, and centrism. They don't like any of that. All right, so that's a very interesting thing. So they gravitate to working with people, or companies, of course, that share these values, or at least understand these values and are willing to authentically, I'm going to use that word again, authentically offer up products and services that kind of fit into this idea. Now, the eclectic thing. You know, the word design is an interesting word. We think of it as graphics and so on, but it's really become much, much bigger. You can design a community, you can design a family or a home, design a company, redesign the processes. Design is taking on a central role in our society and in management and so on. And these people, we'll call them for the time being, we'll call them cultural creatives. I'm not going to use that word hardly anymore. They feel that design is central to their lifestyle and their existence. In fact, what they like to do really is mix opposites. They love diversity. Traditionalists don't like diversity. All right, I think we all know that. They love bringing people together, and not just people, by the way, right? Materials, colors, vivid colors with muted colors, right? Steel industrial materials as well as wood in the same furniture, right? Same interior design. Same environment, same streetscape. Now, nobody would ever have done that 40 years ago. Of course not. Those two materials don't belong together. Those colors don't belong together. But these people, who I now have renamed Urban Naturals, love these eclectic personal collections involving all these different materials. You've seen things like entire trunks of trees kind of cut and they become a pedestal for a steel or a glass dining room table. That's an eclectic, that's an urban natural piece of furniture, right? And if you take a look at a neighborhood where you see industrial and cobblestone, and then you see all these beautiful trees and bushes, and they're really almost overgrown, that's an urban natural environment, all right? So, urban naturalism describes these people that I've been trying to discuss with you, this very unique value system that they have that favors relationships and quality over quantity, right? They're more interested in feelings than they are logic or quantitative acquisition. It's a very important part of our social evolution here. These urban natural people and the furniture, the homes that you'll see metal and wood combined in these beautiful creative ways in all these external buildings and lots more greenery, lots. In fact, there's something called the biophilic research that says if you bring a lot of plants inside of an office environment, employees are 10% more productive, 10%, amazing. That's an incredible breakthrough. Most business owners would love to have all their employees a little more engaged with just bringing in some plants inside the office. So the urban natural revolution, whether it's the city, civic, village, interior design, offices, residences, right? It's here. It's coming. It's momentous. So if you want to sell something to somebody, you better think about figuring out ways to create eclectic packaging, right? Pulling opposites together. Metal and wood would be a great, acrylic and wood, pulling them together into some kind of a design, or looks like it, right? And moving more towards sustainability in your community as well as style. Two S words, sustainability and style. This whole urban natural revolution marries town and country. I want you to think about that now. The convergence of town and country unleashes our highest possibilities. And this, by the way, impacts and redefines community activism, people working with each other, doing things they could never do before, pulling diversity in, setting up these beautiful areas within the community, neighborhoods that have this eclectic notion, this ability to pull things together that would have never been pulled together before, but they're gorgeous in their design, their oppositional contrast. I'm Lynn Hinderacher. Thank you for joining me here on Wild Biz Nebraska. We went all the way from cultural creatives all the way to the urban natural pattern or design in America today. It's here. It's all around you. You'll see furniture, everything, vehicles. It's an amazing thing. I encourage you to try to find a way to adapt your product or service, your environment, your office, your home to attract these people. That's where the future is. And that future, by the way, is right now. I'm Lynn Hinderacher with Wild Biz Nebraska. Thanks for watching. I appreciate it. We'll see you next time.